My name is Emmanuel Urey. I am a pilgrim from Central Liberia.
My country, Liberia, went through a brutal civil war for 14 years. War upon war, and the estimate is like over 250,000 persons lost their lives. However, the war ended, and the country is trying to rebuild itself. Everyone is working now to put the past behind us and move our country forward.
I won a scholarship to study at the University of Wisconsin, and I traveled home to Liberia to visit with my family.
We are on Broad Street. Broad Street is the main street in Monrovia. Happily married to Vivian. Vivian is a crew girl from the southeastern part of Liberia. We do have children.
As I'm in Liberia right now, she's not here. You know, I miss her a lot. They all wish their mother could be here.
This summer, when Emmanuel went to Liberia, I was alone with little Emmanuel. When I called back home to talk to my grandma, my little son, Nelly, who is back in Liberia, he said, "Mommy, there is something in a virus called Ebola in Liberia and it have no cure." Grandma sounded afraid. And she said, "You know, we are living right behind the hospital, JFK, and Ebola is right here in the hospital, and it killed people so fast." I can remember her telling me that we are going to die because that disease is so bad and we cannot control it because we move around, we have to go out to get food. And then when Emmanuel went to Liberia, it got really bad. So I was so worried about him.
Bella B's in the building. Ted World's in the building.
When this virus hit Monrovia, being a student of public health myself, I knew that Liberia was in trouble and we were in trouble.
Since March, the virus continued to spread
through Lofa to Nimba to Monrovia, where we faced the largest urban outbreak of one of the deadliest of disease known to man.
The deadly Ebola virus has now spread to 8 counties.
It now poses serious risks to the health, safety, security, and welfare of our nation. I instructed all non-essential government staff to stay home for 30 days, ordered the closure of schools, and authorized the fumigation of all public buildings. We have shut down markets in affected areas and have restricted movements in others.
The government imposed curfew from 9 p.m. to 6 a.m. No movement.
Who picture is this?
Yeah, who is this?
That all is there so far?
Yes. He got plenty, but he can't pack it.
Yeah, but
we don't know exactly what to do. Particularly when you relate to the little one, the 7-year-old Nettie,
He's young, as young people would do, like in school is closed, so he's not in school. He's with his grandma, and would not normally listen to his grandma.
I think that the children should still go to school because even if they stay home, they can still get in contact with Ebola. So I think that they should go to school. It will be better.
I said God's gonna protect us because it's just hard to resist touching human beings. Yeah, so it's just hard.
It is a dangerous disease. So when it started in West Africa, the information is not clear. People are confused. They didn't understand it.
I'm so downhearted. I just seen Liberian just dying. It's so pity. Every day to tell your friend Bali, go care to the cremation site. It's not a pleasure something to say be taking Bali. And I pray that they violate the country. Because some people, now they are still in denial stage. They are still in denial stage. The common example, PHP, the male wife died. And when I took the body, I gave the health to him. Do not enter the room. We lock the door, everything. We had to send the team to go defend the room. The moment we left last same day, he when he passed the door, he went inside, and his body is in the car. You see the challenge? You tell people, don't do this, they pop behind you and go do it. Don't do this, they say, we are eating free money, the government is lying. If the government is lying, why should we be taking such ballot a day? Daily basis, 17 now.
This disease is heavily controlled through public health awareness and public health infrastructure. Liberia has no public health infrastructure, has no public health aspect of the Ministry of Health and Social Welfare. The country lacks medical doctors and trained professionals.
This situation that we see, I have talked to the PA on the ambulance, and they make me to understand I've seen 12. The girl body was lying here, and they called the Ebola team because they don't have the authority. But when they came on ground, they realized that the child was still moving in her system. But because they are not in power right now, so they called the Ebola team to come quick so that they can be able to save the child's life. From 12 o'clock till now, the Ebola people did not come until that child died in that woman. There's a crisis to the nation to see a pregnant woman die and the child struggling in her system till the child die.
There are a lot of factors that are causing Liberia to have little or no public health infrastructure. Of course, it boils down heavily to the last 14 years of civil war that everything was destroyed in the country.
Liberia was working hard to reconcile people. You know, when the United Nations went in there, tried to train the police and the military to deter further war in the future. But unfortunately, there was nothing done on the side of the health of the population. And here we have the Ebola today, a complete different war that nobody expected.
I saw more and more people arrive at the JFK every day. Medical facilities were unable to cope with a very limited number of doctors. When the nurses at the redemption started dying, the JFK
the ERWA, the Cairo Hospital, things started getting really bad.
At the end of July, when the medical officer of JFK died, the hospital closed down.
I started to worry about, you know, how to get out. At that point, I was trying to bring the kids with me, but that process was not successful totally. I was only able to bring one due to some affidavit issues.
I think I was afraid that many people were going to be dying of the Ebola virus. Three of us, me, Bobby, and Nelly, we should have come at once, but there weren't enough affidavits.
J.U. and I to leave Bobby and Nelly in that situation.
We went to the airport, got on our flight in the night, and flew, and we left.
We're leaving Bobby and Nelly behind. It's like leaving your children in war zone. But it's nice to talk to them to know that they are well and healthy and get the situation they're going through right now.
My brother Keta.
Hello.
Just pray and don't get sick.
Yes, Grandma. I love you too. I'm missing you too. Nelly missing you also too.
I'm trying to help my grandma because she's just depending on me and she have no other person to help her. Everything is getting too expensive right now.
Especially when relating to food. It's actually true that even if the disease subsides, there's going to be a big food crisis in Liberia, no question about it.
The steps taken by the government, it has been helping to escalate the situation. The poor roadblock, soon in the morning, people can't come in, people can't get out.
Across the counties, roadblocks prevented farmers from reaching markets.
For us to pass through here to go in, not easy to get food. Our children are dying with hunger. We want for you to open there, talk to the people there, appeal to them, to open their road for us. We want to pass to go and come. Hunger are for come, so the fire are for come. How will they now?
My concern is we need food and medicine within the community. Our people are suffering, we are suffering. They brought 260 kg bag of rice. Taking one bag of rice and giving that to 2,377 human beings. How much each person will get from that rice?
Then, boom, here we go again. State of emergency. We put a state of emergency. Nobody do this so that we get the government more power. But can the government power solve this problem?
Police enforced a quarantine on West Point, and the whole thing escalated.
What do you want the government to do now?
The government was not to offer now that he is in the now so our children will die. Our children will waste it to the heart.
Now you can hear the
They were sharp. If you're trying to save people from Ebola and turn around, you're shooting them. I don't know what the difference. I don't really know. I don't know what is the difference. You're trying to save people from dying of a sickness, then you're physically shooting them.
Six months into the worst Ebola epidemic in history, the world is losing the battle to contain it. Leaders are failing to come to grip with this transnational threat. In West Africa, cases and death continue to surge. Riots are breaking out. Isolation centers are overwhelmed.
It is the duty of all of us as global citizens to send a message that we will not leave millions of West Africans to fend for themselves against an enemy that they do not know and against whom they have no defense.
The WHO reported like 20,000 or containment within 6 to 9 months, or even more cases, hundreds of thousands, if it is not brought under control. The immediate thing that comes to my mind is to try to get my children out, but I don't have the will or the power to do so.
Even though things are bad for now, we still have people living and we still have people making lives.
We have so many Liberian local NGOs working, creating awareness.
The guy is working on something for Ebola right now. The need to be able to access information, again, that would aid in the enhancement of and fast track of containing this virus was very necessary. So when we put the call out to get in qualified professionals who would come in, they all came specifically as their patriotic duty. They're coming because they want to be a part of the solution.
It is what it is. Hot 107.9, it's your boy DJ Blue, man. From the top of Broad Street, check this out, man. Ebola is real. Take precaution. Watch your hands. Stay at home a little bit, you know? Let the virus subside, and then we can start our normal day activity.
Really, this demon called Ebola took them both. A kid just lost a mother. A mother lost a son. Africa lost another. The battle just begun.
Got my gloves on my hands, but tonight for a different reason.
There are news coming up that some of the hospitals have started operation. They are encouraging the nurses to get back to work and the doctors. So those are good signs, because for all to control the disease, we actually need to have the health centers open and new ones be established.
And people have been surviving. You know, we're getting the situation under control gradually.
On the 17th of September, I was discharged from the unit. And all the nurses, they were very good to me, yes. They were very good. Every time they come around, they would talk to me, encourage me. At times they would come and say, hey, Kufego, let's have devotion. We'll pray and other things. Told me, say, you'll make it. My wife, my 2 years or son, passed out. And my daughter and I survived. So, yeah, since I came back to the community, friends, everybody embraced me. I think this is what really gave me the courage in recovering, because when I came back to the community, there was nothing like stigmatization.
Now we have an international community going in, so I think things are happening on the positive side. 2 weeks or 3 weeks ago, I was thinking that this could degenerate into civil conflict. But right now, I becoming to change that a little bit as people are gaining more confidence again in themselves and in the state as a whole.
We now have hope that indeed we can cross these difficult days We hope that as you work with us and live with us and share with us, there will be a lasting bond of friendship between all of you who have come to be with us, and that together we can march into the future when Ebola has been defeated and we can say to each other, we did it. We won.
As we leave from this war of Ebola, I think one of the lessons that we should learn is that investing in public health infrastructures is as important as trying to prevent civil war. When the disease is contained in 12 months or 18 months, the memory of the disease will remain. It will remain in the human population, it will remain on the landscape in terms of hunger, in terms of food security, in terms of the lives that are lost in the process. The memory is going to continue.